That's what I did. I sat around this morning waiting for the phone to ring, and it did. You are comfortably zoned with me, the Zigzag Man, in Alameda, California, Northern California, as it were, and it is hot in Northern Cali. Whoa, we've had a whole week of hot, and it ain't getting any better. But for me, I got the fan going, and I'm lucky enough to have a return guest, the esteemed Marty Appel. How are you, sir?
I'm good, thank you. Just as hot on the East Coast, if you've been watching the tennis, you know.
Absolutely. I'm fascinated. You mentioned tennis. I'm fascinated with Venus, and I don't know who to root for with Serena and Venus, but she deserves one last go around. She's been ill, and she's made a tremendous comeback the way I look at it. And you and I go back to the New York Sets, the New York Apples, way back, Stahlberg's team.
That's right.
Yeah, that, many a year ago. Billie Jean was on it, and they were good days. They were, you remember how young you were, Marty?
I sure do. I see the photos of all that nice hair on my head.
Right. Hey, you haven't been on since the passing of your brother, and I wanted to acknowledge that and tell you how saddened I was on your behalf.
Thank you. You know, you learn, you pick up life lessons as events like that pass. We weren't especially close. We didn't have a lot in common. I live in the city. He lived in the country. We spoke a few times a year. We weren't estranged. We just didn't have a lot of reason to connect. But suddenly, your brother is gone, and you realize that when you think of things from your childhood, he was the only one left on the planet who would get it. You know, he was there. And there's a void that has nothing to do with reaching out and calling him. It's just the existence of somebody else on the planet who shared that experience is a big loss.
Right. And my sincere condolences.
Thank you.
All right. Let's try to get on to a happier subject. And for me, that's my memories. Especially of the 50s and 60s baseball memories. And the New York Giants had left in 1957, and I was, if not a Yankee fan, certainly not a Yankee fan, but I was a Yankee worshiper. I couldn't believe what we were seeing. We saw two separate dynasties where the Yankees in from 1949 to 1953, and this was Casey Stengel's first year in 49, they won five in a row, and this is when there were eight teams in each league, and it was pre-expansion. It was incredible. And you wrote an article about those days, and I think when you talk about those Yankees, it all starts with Casey and George Weiss. They were a hell of a combination. Your article was for the National Pastime Newsletter, and it was it asked the rhetorical question, was Casey Stengel a racist? And your article was terrific because it just covered the times. And would you put it in your own words for me, Marty?
Sure. I'm writing a Casey Stengel biography now that it'll be out in about a year and a half. And when I tell people I'm doing it, invariably they ask me that question, was Casey Stengel a racist? And he sort of has that reputation off one quote of his, which was really just a throwaway line, an attempt at humor, where in talking about Elston Howard, he said, I finally get one and he can't run. And probably everybody in the room snickered when he said it.
Right.
And he may not have said one when he said, I finally get one, because
no, I know. He used the N-word.
We have to put that into context.
What were people saying in those days? When in 1951, when in the World Series, when the New York Giants put three blacks together in the outfield, Don Mueller was hurt, Hank Thompson went to right, Willie was playing center, and Monty Irvin left. It was the first time that three blacks had ever been in the same outfield, and there were written or published little ditties about that, racist ditties published in the mainstream newspaper. So putting what he said about Howard into context, it was what it was. It wasn't pretty. I don't think Casey Stengel was a racist. I think the Yankee organization in those days, headed by George Weiss, who, in my opinion, was a racist, worked to keep blacks from playing on the Yankees. And Vic Power is a great example.
A lot of what you said is true. I think it's important to also note, in the sense of context, that there was pressure on the Yankees to integrate the roster, but on the other hand, they'd won five straight world championships. There was no great cry to shake things up or do anything differently. And coincidentally, they finally lost in 1954. They finished in second place. And what do you know, 1955, here comes Elston Howard. Maybe a coincidence, but probably, you know, a message to them that it was time. In terms of the organization being racist and they're not retaining Vic Power, it was whispered that Vic Power dated white women, which certainly wouldn't have been approved by most
right.
parts of society back then, and that he was too flashy. And he was a flashy player, but you know what? The Yankees didn't take flashy white guys either. It was
right.
a very staid, conservative organization. Elston Howard was the perfect guy. He came along as, you know, with the gentlemanly manners that the Yankees looked for in all their players. And he was accepted immediately by everybody on the team, including the Southerners, including the coaches, Bill Dickey from Little Rock and Jim Turner from Nashville, by Mickey Mantle from Oklahoma City, from Oklahoma. And Ellie was just a wonderful guy. I was fortunate to know him for many years. He was the perfect guy at the right time, and Casey certainly had no problems with him. And that little one-liner joke kind of stayed as part of Casey's legacy.
Right. There were a limited number of blacks playing for the Yankees. Vic Power never did play. Harry Suitcase Simpson, played a bit with them. And a catcher from McClyman's High School in Oakland, close to where I am, like 10, 15 minutes away in Northern California, Jesse Gonder, who later on went to play with the Mets. But I wanted to mention to you, Marty, the significance of McClyman's High School. Okay. In the very early 50s, McClyman's had an outfield that consisted of Frank Robinson, Veda Pinson, and Curt Flood, all in one outfield.
Same time?
At the same time.
Wow.
It was only one year when they played the same time. I think it was Curt Flood played at another high school after that, or might have been Pinson. No, it was Curt Flood indeed, because Pinson and Robinson were signed by Cincinnati out of that high school. And that was the high school that Bill Russell happened to play for, McClyman's High School in Oakland. So I thought I'd mention that to you.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah. You've given me a fact or two to chew on over the years with your writing. We never did talk about the book that you republished, the Yankee book that you republished, especially for children. And if you would mention that a little bit.
Sure, thank you. In 2012, we did Pinstripe Empire, which was the history of the Yankees. And it was very well received, happy to say, and kind of has been accepted as the definitive Yankee history. So Simon and Schuster came to me and said, would you like to do a children's version? So it's not a abridged version. It's a totally start from scratch, do it originally version. And it's for young readers, say 8 to 12, and it's the history of the Yankees. So it's called Pinstripe Pride, to kind of keep the sound of the title alive.
Right.
Came out this year and has also been well received. Parents shopping in bookstores like to buy Yankee books for their kids. So we've got both Pinstripe Empire and Pinstripe Pride out there now at the same time.
Wow. Very cool. Yeah, I may have asked you this question before. Is there anything in Pinstripe Empire that you thought of after the completion of the book, wish you had put in? And conversely, is there anything in the book that you wrote that you really wish you would have said differently or even left out altogether?
That's a great question. I'm kind of proud to be able to say basically no. I had enough time to write it where things that I might have forgotten or not put enough emphasis on the first time through, by the time it was ready to hand it in, I think I got it all. And so I don't think I left anything out. I mean, it's 600 pages.
Right.
Could have been 1,000, but we
didn't
cover it.
Right, it could have been 1,000. Was it edited after you completed it with consultation? Did you go back and forth with editors? Did you trust them implicitly? What's it like to complete a book?
I try
to complete reading a book every now and again, let alone writing a book.
The publisher is Bloomsbury, based here in New York and also in London. I had a terrific two editors, actually, that went through it. One goes through it for spelling and grammar and, you know, sentence construction, and others go through it with questions about the facts that you present. That was the important step, and they were great about it. It was a real baseball fan, not a Yankees fan, but it was a real baseball fan that was the editor, Ben Adams. And when I went to the manuscript, which was about 1,000 pages, he had the yellow sticky notes in there that I almost fainted when I first saw them. There must have been 300. And so we sat and covered them all, and I answered his questions and sometimes changed the way we presented an era a little bit. But it was a great process. That's what you want out of a publisher. You want them to have an editor there who knows the material, asks good questions. There's a lot of books out there that are published, self-published or published by small publishers, that simply don't have the manpower to do something like that. So they are what they are, but for an astute reader, they should know if it's a small publisher, you probably don't have an editor who's asking hard questions and making you present facts perhaps in a different way.
Okay. After the Casey book, what inspired you for the Casey book? There have been Creamer had a biography of Casey. He's been well written about. What are you bringing to the table in your own mind that will make this book stand out?
Okay. First, the idea was the publishers, in this case Doubleday, that did my Thurman Munson book. Jason Kaufman is the editor there. He does Dan Brown also, the Da Vinci Code and all the subsequent Dan Brown books.
Oh.
And he came to me and suggested Casey Stengel. And I said, well, that's a tall task, because Bob Creamer's book on KC was so good. He said, yeah, well, that was 30 years ago. It's time for a fresh new biography. So I took it, and then I contacted Casey and Edna Stengel's grandniece, who lives in Nevada. And I've known her over the years. She's kind of the keeper of the family legacy. And God bless her, she gave me an unpublished memoir by Edna Stengel from 1958 that had material that Bob Creamer never had access to, probably wasn't aware of, and that was a wonderful find, so I'm really able to put a lot of new things in this.
What? Tell me something about Casey that I might not know, and some of our listeners might not know.
Well, I'm just overwhelmed by the span of history that he experienced. I mean, he became a professional baseball player in 1910. He was born before Babe Ruth. And in his career, he just played with or against everybody. There was nobody in baseball he didn't know. When Sandy Koufax pitched a no-hitter against the Mets, when he was managing the Mets, he was able to say, well, he's terrific. He's a wonderful pitcher, but the best I ever saw was Grover Cleveland Alexander. And he could talk about batting against Grover Cleveland Alexander or playing center field in a game where Babe Ruth was just breaking in with the Boston Red Sox. So the wealth of this man's history and his retention of all his knowledge expressed oddly in a Stengelese style of speaking was just wonderful to behold. He knew everybody.
Well, I just thinking off the top of my head, I think his major contribution was the instructional league. I don't think anybody had done that before, and I really think that contributed to the dynasty that that took place under his guidance.
It's true, and also advanced scouting started with him, where you'd send a scout to watch the next couple of teams that you were going to play, and they'd come back and give a report. So there were a lot of things set in motion there, partly because the Yankees had more money than anybody else and could do things like that, like the instructional league. He was an innovator. He's credited probably more than he should be as the innovator of platoon baseball. I mean, baseball managers had always known that righties do better against lefties and lefties do better against righties. They just didn't always have the manpower to support that. But Casey did, and he used it to his advantage. And except for Yogi Berra, he was forever moving people in and out of the lineup depending on who was pitching, and he came to be acknowledged as a genius in doing that.
And you can't do that without the pieces to move. I mean, so let's talk about the man who I consider the most important versatile player of Casey's time, and that's Gil McDougald. Number 12, Gil McDougald. Number 12. Gil was one of the people that I really admired because of what my grandfather taught me, and that was the word utility and the importance of utility players in baseball. And let it be said that Gil, playing second as a regular, playing short as a regular, and playing third as a regular, in three separate years, they won world championships with him as the starter. And not to say he didn't move around during the year, pinch hitters, platoons, that sort of thing. Tell me something about Gil McDougald.
Well, he was one of those guys that spent his whole career with just the Yankees, never anybody else. He was the Rookie of the Year in 1951, which was Mickey Mantle's rookie year, so he beat out Mickey for that.
And Jackie Jensen's rookie year as well.
That's right. Gil hit a grand slam in that year's World Series. He made the All-Star team as a second baseman, as a shortstop, and as a third baseman. And he
didn't know that.
Yeah, it was,
I know they won. They won in those years. He was at third in 51, you know, so on, so on. Yeah,
a lot of people also remember that he hit the ball that got Herb Score in the eye.
Yes,
which he carried as a burden in his consciousness for his whole life. It was a horrible thing to witness. You never see it because it wasn't filmed or videotaped or anything, so it was a moment that's, you know, left to our imagination, but it must have been an awful thing to see. Coincidentally, Gil himself had been hit in the head in spring training just like a month or two before. And
really? I didn't know
that.
Yeah,
and a lot of people attributed his later deafness to that injury.
Yes, he lost his hearing, and miraculously, there was a technique too shortly before he passed where he regained at least a portion of his hearing. He was able to communicate with his grandchildren, and that was a touching story.
Yeah, it's actually the same surgery that I think Rush Limbaugh underwent, where hearing was restored. So,
yeah, well, his side effects, he became a bloated asshole. no, I don't mean to say that.
Yes, you do.
Then again, yes, I do. Yes, I have to say it. What can I say? Yeah, Gil was terrific, and they had a glut of infielders. They had Andy Carey. They had Bobby Richardson coming up. So what Casey was given to his pawns to move around were damn good ball players.
Jerry Tolman.
He was so slick on the double play. He
as versatile as McDougald.
You come to think of it, he played all over. He had Billy Martin in the equation. You want to talk about Casey and Billy's relationship a little bit? With that,
sure. Yeah, very important. Casey managed Billy in Oakland in the Pacific Coast League, which was, you know, like Billy's hometown.
Right.
And
Billy was from Berkeley, which is right across the border from Oakland. Yeah.
And they won a championship with Oakland in 48. Casey went to the Yankees in 49. Billy came up a year later. And he was considered like Casey's boy because Casey had sort of been a father figure to him in the minors and brought him along. And he was kind of, you know, when I said earlier that the Yankees didn't take flashy white guys either, Billy was kind of an exception because he was designated by Casey as the kind of guy that he wanted on his team. It was a dramatic moment in 1957 when Billy was traded and he felt that Casey could have spoken up for him, could have prevented the trade. Why didn't he do that? And forever on, Billy just was so hurt by Casey kind of turning his back and letting Billy be traded. So that's kind of a dramatic point in the book, and we resolve that in the book through conversations with other people, where Billy was a very emotional guy, wore it all on his sleeve, couldn't believe Casey would turn on him.
Right.
And to Casey, when asked about it, it was like, tell Billy Martin to grow up. This is the industry he's in. People get traded all the time. He's making much too big a deal out of this. So that was kind of interesting, too, that Casey lacked that sentiment when the moment was there, because it was, hey, this is the way things are, you know?
Yeah, well, Casey really basically raised him, because Billy was without a father growing up. And I think it was callous. I don't think he had much pull. I think George Weiss really ran the ship in terms of that. And I think Casey did at least go to bat for him. He tried. But they reconciled.
They sort of did near the end. Billy wrote Casey a letter when he was managing Texas in 75. And Casey, you know, responded to the letter kind of saying, I never had anything against you, and, you know, glad to see you're managing successfully and so forth. Casey died later that year, Billy was the only Yankee representative at the funeral, was the only Yankee to wear a black armband during the 1976 season. The whole team didn't, just Billy did. Billy actually slept in Casey's bed at his Glendale home the night before the funeral.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I don't know what to make of that.
Yeah.
I'm stunned at that. I mean, that is stunning. Hey, Marty, your time is limited. You bless the show when you come on. I'm really proud to have you, and I hope you'll keep coming back from time to time.
Always enjoy talking with you. Thanks for having me.
Beautiful. I'm going to end the episode like I do everyone by imploring you and my guests to keep your dreams wet and your humor dry. Keep your children out of military recruiting offices. It's very, very important. And also off the laps of clerics that wear dresses. Your family will be enriched by that. And I just want to say thanks again, Marty. And adios, muchachos and muchachas.
Thank you.